I've been talking about the design of a CMOS inverter in sub-threshold regime of device operations. And in previous class, we discussed about determining the various important parameters of a CMOS inverter. We discussed how VOH, VOL, VIH, and VIL can be determined. And from these parameters value, we can determine the noise margins of the inverter circuit. And then thereafter we discuss about the power dissipations. We discuss about how the switching power dissipation and how the short circuit power dissipation can be computed. So the procedure of determining the short circuit power dissipation is similar to that of the conventional case. The only difference here we see is when the input signal takes off, when it goes above zero, the short circuit current starts increasing immediately. So to find out the average of the short circuit current, basically we need to consider this particular shape of the short circuit current. And we discussed in the previous class how we can get the expression for the short circuit current. So for the expression for the short circuit current, where the input voltage was replaced by VDD into T upon TR, and the output voltage, since it was varying with respect to time, and this will lead to a complicated expression for ISCT, it was approximated to be equal to VDD by 2, and the short circuit current expression is used now to compute the average short circuit current, which is 1 upon capital T 0 to T ISCT and DT. And then to utilize the fact that the two shapes here, this lobe and this lobe, these are identical to each other. This fact can be used in order to simplify this integration. And we get the following simplified short circuit current expression, which is proportional to, you can see the short circuit current is proportional to exponential of the minus threshold voltage divided by NN phi t. And it's also proportional to the rise time and inversely proportional to the time period of the input signal. So from this average current, short circuit current, the average power dissipation, short circuit power dissipation can be computed using this expression VDD multiplied by ISC average. And since the current has a certain dependency on the threshold voltage and parameter, so this average power dissipation will also follow the similar trend. The power dissipation goes proportional to e to the power minus VTHN upon NN phi t, and it is proportional to TR, the rise time. So if the rise time is significant, then the two transistors will be conducting together for a longer time period, and therefore the short circuit power dissipation is going to be more. And similarly, if the clock frequency is high, then again the short circuit power dissipation is going to be high. Then the another parameter of any digital circuit is the fan out. And fan out can be determined by looking at the acceptable propagation delay. So, for example, this one CMOS inverter is driving a capital N number of another CMOS. By increasing the number of the gates that are being driven by this gate, we are going to increase the load capacitance for this inverter. And increasing load capacitance, increasing load for this inverter is going to increase the delay. So we'll have to see that what is the maximum allowed delay for the circuit, and we can compute the maximum allowed delay. We can compute the maximum allowed delay using we can compute the total delay considering n number of gates as a load, and then that can be compared with allowed propagation delay, and from that expression we can determine that what could be the maximum, what could be the fan out for the CMOS inverter, for the CMOS inverter. So here, as we have already discussed the formula for the propagation delay. So the same formula is used. Propagation delay is earlier it was C out here, the total capacitance, load capacitance, but now the C out is replaced by N max into C in. What is considered here, the C in is the capacitance, input capacitance of load inverter stage. So approximations are made here, the interconnect capacitances are neglected, and also the parasitic capacitance of this CMOS inverter is also neglected. So the total load capacitance is considered to be N max into C in only. When this is compared with the total propagation delay TB max, then we can solve that the right hand side cannot be greater than this TP max. So based on this inequality, we can find out the N max value. So N max should be greater than equal to this. So we have to solve this exponential expressions, we little bit complicated expressions. See what is the nearest integer, and that will be the fan out for the CMOS inverter. So this is the practice which is used not only for this case, the general approach, and it is used to compute the fan out for a given digital circuit. Then the transistor sizing. So transistor sizing is very interesting in subthreshold case. In conventional case, in order to ensure that the rise time and fall time of the output waveform is equal, we have to make sure that the drive current, I mean the current that is passing through the N transistor, equal to that of the current that will pass through the P transistor. So the two currents should deliver the equal amount of the current in the conventional circuits, and based on that this equation is derived, mu n time W by L into N equal to mu P time W by L into P. If we ensure this, then we can ensure that the two transistor will deliver the same current if their threshold voltages are same in magnitude. So however, in subthreshold case, it may happen that for a particular technology node, the NMOS transistor can deliver less current than the P transistor. So in that case, the N transistor should be sized properly so that that will match the current with the P transistor. So unlike the conventional CMOS inverter case, where the W by L ratio of the P transistor is greater than the W by L ratio of the N transistor, the P transistor generally is considered to be wider than the N transistor in order to match the current. In the substitute case, even the vice versa is possible. Even Thus, in some cases, N transistor should be made wider so that minimize the current of a P transistor, because this is a leakage current. And you can see the sort channel effects can be higher in P transistor case, and so there could be larger threshold voltage roll off, and because of that the P transistor can deliver a larger current for the same transistor for the same size and other parameters of the transistor. The transistor sizing will be done depending upon the technology, but the basic concept remains same, that we have to ensure the two transistors will conduct equal current, P transistor during the charging period, N transistor during the discharging period, so that a symmetrical output waveform can be obtained. So this is the basis for the transistor sizing. It is a little bit different than the conventional case. Okay, so now we can look at some the graphs that are plotted using these expressions. So I have to open another. Okay, I have to. Is it visible? These pictures. Can you see the pictures?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So here to plot the graphs, you can see that the parameters that are taken for the NMOS transistor, the oxide thickness is 2.2 nanometer, permittivity is 3.9, oxide capacitance is 0.0157 farad per meter square. And electronic mobility is only 360 centimeter square per volt second, because it's a scale device, and a scale device surface mobility is much less than the bulk mobility. And the threshold voltage of the N transistor is considered to be 0.38 volt. The corresponding value for the PMOS devices, the oxide thickness is 2.2 nanometer. Epsilon 3.9. The hole mobility is around 145 centimeter square per volt second. The threshold voltage of the P transistor is minus 0.45. This is not exactly equal to that of the N transistor in magnitude. And the aspect ratio of the two devices is put equal to 2. So the value adopted for the alpha is basically 1, frequency is 10 kilohertz, and the rise time is 10 microsecond, and the output capacitance Cout is around 100 femtofarad. So considering these parameters, the structure is simulated in 45 nanometer using the model parameters of 45 nanometer technology node. And the simulation result is like this. So simulation result is shown by this dotted line, you can see. So this dotted line is not showing the perfectly symmetrical inverter characteristics, because as we have seen in the parameters value, the two transistors are not matched properly. The VTHN and VTHP are different. And things are also not clear about the scale current, about the sizing of the transistors. Okay. For analysis, however, the mathematical expressions that are derived are used to plot the VTC. And in this case, the transistors are matched properly and you can see that a perfectly symmetrical VTC is observed with VOH around 0.35 volt and VOL is approximately equal to zero. And similarly, the VIH is around VIL is around 0.15 voltage volt and VIH is VIL is around this for analysis it is 0.178 volt and VIH is around 0.1986 volt and the inverter threshold voltage is found to be around 0.1887. So the VTC is, you can see, is pretty similar to that of a conventional CMOS inverter, and by proper sizing and matching the parameters of the transistors, by proper sizing the transistors and by matching the parameters of the transistor, we can get a characteristics like to that of a conventional CMOS inverter case. Here, the propagation delay is basically it's high to low propagation delay is plotted against the threshold voltage of NMOS transistor, and you can see that this graph is plotted for a constant supply voltage. So if for a constant supply voltage, when the threshold voltage is increased, so the increasing threshold voltage is now responsible for the increasing propagation delay. Similarly, here in this graph, you can see that the high to low propagation delay is plotted versus the power supply voltage, and you can see that when the power supply voltage is scaled down, then the propagation delay increases. Okay, this trend is similar to that of the conventional case, but the only difference that you should notice is the order of the propagation delay. If you look at the order of the propagation delay, this range is microsecond, which is much larger than that of a conventional CMOS inverter, because in conventional CMOS inverter this could be in nanosecond or picoseconds depending upon the technology used, but here it is in the microsecond, and that is one of the important observation when this we also discussed in the beginning, that design is primarily aiming the power reduction, but the price that we pay is the increased delay. So increased delay, if it is acceptable for certain applications, this could be good for a this topology, this designing could be good for a very low power applications. So again, in this case, the low to high propagation delay is plotted versus the threshold voltage of the P transistor. And again, in this case, you can see that with increasing threshold voltage, now in this case, the threshold voltage is increasing from right to left. So with increasing threshold voltage, again, delay increases. The low to high propagation delay increases for the CMOS inverter case. Here the average propagation delay, the half of the high to low plus low to high propagation delay versus the threshold voltage. This is magnitude of the threshold voltage. So you can see that with increasing threshold voltage, if the supply voltage is a constant, then the propagation delay will be increasing with the threshold voltage. And here comes to the total power consumptions in watt versus the power supply voltage, and theoretically, again, you can show that with reducing supply voltage, with decreasing supply voltage, you can see that the power consumption will be decreasing significantly. And other parameters to note is order of this power dissipation. This is 1.4 into 10 to the power minus 10 watt is very small than that of a conventional CMOS inverter case. So with this, we are going to finish our discussion on the CMOS inverter design in the subthreshold case. And the summary is, this is a this design is basically useful because the circuit is designed at low supply voltage. So low supply voltage will reduce the power dissipation, will be responsible for the low power requirement. But the price we pay is the propagation delay, larger propagation delay. So far, we have been discussing about the various techniques that are useful for basically the techniques that we have been discussed so far were based on the supply voltage scaling. So by reducing supply voltage, we can reduce, we can minimize the switching power dissipation. We can also minimize the leakage power dissipation. From now onward, in next two lectures, we'll be talking about we'll be talking about the reduction of dynamic power dissipation. But this dynamic power dissipation will now emphasize not on the supply voltage scaling, but on the other parameter, which is called the switching capacitance. So switching capacitance is in power dissipation, dynamic power dissipation expression, you seen that the dynamic power dissipation is equal to F into alpha CL VDD square. So we are going to now concentrate on alpha into CL. So I have to actually open a new PowerPoint presentation. See the slides.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the title is switched capacitance minimization. So now we'll be talking about the power reduction technique, which is based on the switching capacitance minimization. So switching capacitance can be minimized either by reducing the load capacitance or by reducing the switching activity. Combinedly, if alpha and CL are combined together, we call we'll refer that as a switch capacitance, and we'll be discussing about the techniques which are used for minimizing alpha times CL so that we could minimize the dynamic power dissipation. And essentially, we are going to talk about the following techniques that will be useful for minimizing the switching capacitance, switched capacitance. Techniques are hardware software core design, bus encoding, clock gating. We'll be talking about finite state machine clock gating, finite state machine state encoding, finite state machine partitioning, operand isolation, and the pre-computations. You might have been heard about these topics in different courses, but here these topics will be discussed in a particular context, the context of the switching power, switching capacitance minimization at the different level of design abstraction. So the first technique we are going to talk about is hardware software core design. This hardware software core design is a system level approach, and a given problem can be solved by designing a hardware for that, or it could be a combination of hardware and software, both. So here one example is taken. You can see that let's say that at room temperature has to be monitored. So to monitor a room temperature, this hardware is implemented. Okay, so what we have a temperature sensor. So temperature sensor will be converting the physical signal into the electrical form, and that electrical signal, analog signal, is given to an analog to digital converter ADC, and this ADC is being controlled by a microcontroller here. So the microcontroller is going to read the data that is provided by ADC and will process that data. And there are two additional lines here just to interact to ensure the proper interaction between the this A to D converter and the microcontroller. So there is a start convert line. So through this line, the microprocessor will send information to this ADC and this EOC, end of conversion line. The ADC will send a signal to microcontroller that the process has been over. So to communicate, to ensure the proper communication between the ADC, analog to digital converter, and microcontroller, these two lines are present: start convert and end of the conversion line. So so this technique is basically mainly focused on the hardware, cost hardware, which is an analog to digital converter. And the attributes of this implementation of the problem is the operation will be very fast, and the lower conversion time and fast sampling rate is possible. Okay. So operation will be fast, and lower conversion time and fast sampling rate is possible. But the overhead that you pay is the high cost, because ADC will be a costly hardware, maybe of typical value, maybe let's say 500 rupees. So here the problem that was designed is primarily based on the hardware, because the software requirement is very, very less. In this case, a very simple software code is required that will ensure the proper communication between the ADC and the microcontroller. So this technique is relying mainly on the hardware, which is A to D converter. Now the same problem can be implemented in a little bit different fashion. So in this approach, we have a microcontroller. We are not using an analog to digital converter, but rather we are going to use a less costlier, a cheaper DAC, digital to analog converter, DAC. So the DAC output is given to a comparator here, and the output of this DAC is given to this comparator, and the another input of this comparator is the analog signal that receiving from the transducers, which is converting the temperature to electrical signal, an electrical signal. So this comparator is going to compare the two input signals and will provide provide output accordingly to this microcontroller. And in this case, basically a algorithm has to be implemented in the microcontroller. That algorithm could be the successive approximation algorithm of let's say D to A conversion. So in this case, the hardware requirement is not hardware requirement is not as significant as in the previous case. In the previous case, one ADC was required, but here less costlier DAC is used here, but the design is here mainly focused on the software code, which is basically the implementation of a successive approximation algorithm. So more emphasis is on the software and less emphasis is on the hardware to implement the same problem. And what is the result? The result is the lower chip area requirement is now reduced, high software overhead because now we have to implement this successive approximation algorithm for this conversion. And so the trade off between the hardware and software has to be always made in a bigger problem that is to be implemented. So in hardware software code design, so hardware software code design is a very very important aspect of designing. You can see that here a typical code design process is shown. So a typical code design process, so first you will have a system level description of a given problem, and then that problem will be partitioned into hardware and the software, which functionality is to be implemented by hardware and what to be implemented by the software, that has to be decided first. And then the hardware software code synthesis is carried out. So this hardware part, the software part, in a conventional design approach, the hardware part and the software part, these two will be implementation were done independently. Once the hardware software partitioning is done, then the hardware and software were implemented independently. Then the system level integration is done, and then we go for prototyping. But in hardware software code designing approach, the software and hardwares are implemented concurrently. They cannot be independent. They cannot be independently implemented. So the importance of this interface is significant in this case. So this interface will ensure that the software and hardware will be implemented concurrently, and so that we'll get the best solution. And once these are implemented, then system level integration will be done, post simulation will be performed. If the results are not as per expectation, then we can again go for a hardware software partitioning approach at hardware software partitioning stage, and again the problem will be partitioned based on the hardware and software to be implemented, and then this process will be go on till we get a best solution for the given system level description. So this is the hardware software code design approach, which will ensure that the hardware and softwares will be implemented concurrently in order to ensure the best performance and lesser silicon area requirement, lesser silicon area. So this is a very very interesting approach, which is widely used for the microprocessor design. So now we are going to talk about the two architectures. One is the first one is superscalar architecture, and the second one is VLIW architecture. I hope that you have already gone through these topics in your high performance computing course. Here I will just give you the brief idea about these architectures, and I will just try to emphasize how a proper hardware software code designing is going to ensure the that the power requirement will be less, switching activity will be less, and therefore the power requirement will be less. So first of all, let us talk about this super scalar architecture. So have you already studied this in your high computing course? Yes.
No, sir.
So, okay. So I will give you some brief idea what this super scalar architecture is. So this super scalar architecture it supports the instruction level parallelism. Okay, we discuss about the parallelism at the hardware level where the hardware is duplicated. Okay, in order to increase the throughput of the system to improve the performance of the system. Okay, so similarly, a super scalar architecture is one which supports the instruction level parallelism. Means in older days the processors were not so strong and they could only support one function at a given time. But nowadays you see that multi-core even processors are being implemented, being designed and fabricated. So they are able to provide, they are very, very strong and they can support multiple functions at the same time. So the instruction level parallelism is quite useful because a number of instructions, more than one instructions, can be implemented at the same time, and therefore the performance of the system can be improved. Okay, so here the architecture of a super scalar architecture is shown here. So the super scalar architecture is basically adopted in the advanced 86 processor, 286, 386, 486, Pentium 2, Pentium 3. Intel basically adopts this structure. So the instructions that is executed are basically in 86 processors. The instructions that are executed are CISC instruction, complex instructions, and the CISC instructions are basically decoded by this super scalar decode unit. And the super scalar with the super scalar decode unit decodes those instructions and translate those instructions into the simple RISC-like instruction, reduced instructions set. So the RISC-like instructions are finally converted into the micro operations. Micro operations are given to the dispatch unit, and the dispatch unit will dispatch those micro operations to the different functional units. There will be multiple functional unit into the processor. Each and every functional unit will be performing what is being dispatched by this dispatch unit, and then functions will that are performed here will be reordered properly by this in order and retire unit. So the point that is to be noted in this case is for this super scalar architecture is the decoding and the translation of the CISC instruction into the RISC instruction and finally the micro operation performed by the hardware. Okay, we have this translation unit, we have dispatch unit, we have this super scalar decoder unit, and these units are implemented by power hungry transistors. So this architecture is, although it improves the performance because multiple instructions are being executed at the same time, but the biggest problem will be the silicon overhead. Larger silicon area is required to implement these hardwares, and also at the same time the power requirement will be more because the power hungry transistors, when they will perform these activity, they need to be driven by a power supply, so the power requirement will be very, very high in this case. So the super architecture, super scalar architectures are very efficient in terms of performance. They perform really well, but at the cost of silicon area and the large power dissipation. So alternative of these super scalar architecture could be a PLIW, which is very long instruction word architecture, PLIW architecture. So it also takes advantage of a instruction level parallelism, but not in the same way as the super scalar architecture does. Happens in this VLIW architecture is VLIW consists of multiple independent operations grouped together. A VLIW, very long instruction word. In VLIW architectures, we use very long instruction word, VLIW. We call it very long instruction word because it could be vary from 64 bit to, let's say, 1024 bit. It could be a very, very long instruction, and a single instructions will include the multiple independent operations. Multiple independent operations are grouped together in a single instruction. In previous case, there were multiple instructions to be executed at the same time in super scalar approach. Here, a single instruction will be including a number of operations together. So one of the typical example here is shown, you can see in this picture, where you can see that a number of atoms are there in a given molecule. So this VLIW instructions are sometime called as molecule in some processor. So in a bigger molecule, there will be smaller atoms, and each atoms has to perform a different task. For example, this is, you can see that floating point addition is to be performed, then addition is to be performed, and then load store to be performed, and the branch related operations are to be performed here. So all these operations are included in a single instruction. You can see that these operations will be, of course, performed by the different functional unit, like the super scalar architecture. The only difference is the way the tasks are basically scheduled. And you can see that in VLIW architecture, the role of compiler is very, very important. VLIW compiler is responsible for scheduling of the instructions. Instructions will be scheduled by the compiler, and the compilers basically finds out what operations to be executed next and what operations can be executed in parallel. And then based on that, the compiler group together those operations in a single instruction word, which is called basically VLIW, a very long instruction word. And the instruction size can be from 64 bit to 1028 bit, unlike the super scalar approach where one instruction could be of 32 bit. Okay. So in this VLIW architecture, there are more emphasis is on the software. Super scalar approach, it is the hardware that is performing this decoding and the translation, and then the micro operations will be generated from the instructions, and then the dispatch unit is dispatching all those to the functional unit. These things are actually being done by the hardware. In a VLIW architecture, the instructions will be created by the VLIW compiler. So many operations that are to be executed in the previous super scalar case will be executed here with the help of software. So more emphasis will be on the software in the VLIW architecture, and less emphasis is on the hardware. So if a processor is implemented, processor have the same capability is implemented using this VLIW architecture, then you can see that the silicon area can be saved, and also the power switching activity can be minimized. Therefore, the power requirement can also be minimized in this in the processor which is based on VLIW architecture. Okay, so to differentiate the SuperSQ and VLIW architecture, you can look at these two pictures. So here the SuperScalar architecture, basically you can see that the instruction is fetched from the instruction register, and then this will be decoded and dispatched. So multiple instructions are being fetched at the same time, and then these instructions are basically dispatched to the different functional unit. But in VLIW architecture, the single the instruction will be so long, and a single instruction will be having will have to perform the many operations, and so those operations are basically mapped to the different functional unit. This is the difference between the SuperScalar and VLIW. VLIW is based more is relied on the software, whereas the SuperScalar architecture relies on the hardware, more on the hardware. So here a comparison is made. You can see that some processors are actually compared. Here Pentium 1, P1, Pentium 2, Pentium 3 processors, which are based on the SuperScalar architecture, these three processors. And here the TM3120 and TM540, these are Transmeta processors. So the Transmeta processors are basically compatible to 86 instructions. Like these P1, P2, and P3 processors. So for an external user, these Transmeta processors are similar to that of the Pentium, the 86 processors. But the internal things are actually different here. These are the internal. There will be VLIW engine in the Transmeta processor. And the VLIW engine will basically, and the and at the outer level of the interface, or the machine human interface, basically there will be 86 kind of instructions, and there will be a code morphing software that will actually map the 86 instructions of the Transmeta processor to that will map to that will make those compatible for VLIW engine, which will actually perform the actual task. So if these processors are compared here, so you can see that the process technology that is used for P1 is 0.25 micron, for P2 it is again 0.25 micron, P3 is based on 0.18 micron. Transmeta is based on 0.22 micron, so it's almost comparable to that of P1 and P2. And the Transmeta 5400 advanced version of this is based on 0.18 micron, like this Pentium 3 processor. So on-chip L1 cache memory is 32 kilobit for P1, 32 kilobit for P2, 32 kilobit for P3. For Transmeta, you can see it's 96 kilobit, and it is 128 kilobit for Transmeta 5400. So these are basically required, because as you know that Transmeta is more Transmeta is based on gives more emphasis to the software. So more the software to facilitate the operations, basically the on-chip memory need to be larger for that in the transmitter processor, and that's why larger memories are actually implemented on the processor chip. So L2 cache is absent in P1, it's 256 in P2 and 256 kilobyte in P3. For transmitter 3120 it is absent, but in transmitter 5400 it is present with 256 kilobyte. The interesting thing that is to be noted is the die size, the area requirement. You can see that for P1 it is 130 millimeter square, P2 180 millimeter square, for Pentium 3 it was 106 millimeter square, whereas for both version of the transmitter processor, for 3120 it's only 77 millimeter square, and for transmitter TM5400 it is around 73 millimeter square. So the processor area is the silicon overhead is very very less in transmitter processor compared to that of Pentium processors, in spite of the fact that the transmitter processors have higher you can see cache, L1 cache memory, I mean bigger L1 cache memories. So it's because the transmitter processors are more based on software, and less emphasis is given to the design, less emphasis is given to the hardware in this case. So extra hardware for Pentium processors are required, and therefore you can see the die size is bigger in Pentium case compared to the transmitter case. So this is the die size comparison, the silicon overhead comparison. If power, if you can see that in the next picture, the temperature profile is shown for a equal load. The load may be of, let's say, playing of a DVD. If this is being performed by, you can see in first picture, the temperature profile of a superscalar Pentium 3 processor is shown here. In the second picture, the temperature profile of a transmitter 5400 processor is shown here. They have to perform the same function, that is, let's say, the playing of a DVD. And for this particular load, just look at the temperature profile of the superscalar Pentium processor. So here you can see that the maximum temperature goes up to 105.5 degrees centigrade. So this may be a cause of reliability. This could be a reliability issue, because such a high temperature can be responsible for the breakdown in the transistors, and there could be a number of things that can happen which can alter the performance of the actual chip, the processor. But in this case, you can see for the transmitter processor to perform the same function, temperature profile is very less. The temperature, maximum temperature, goes up to 48.2 degree centigrade. So it's clearly indicates that the power requirement and the power dissipation is very very less in transmitter processor compared to that of the Pentium processor. Because Pentium processor maximum temperature goes 105 degree centigrade, and here the maximum temperature goes only to 48.2 degree centigrade. This is the switch capacitance minimization. This is based on the capacitance minimization by hardware and software co-designing. So in this approach, basically the weightages of the hardware and software should be given in such a way that we get the best performance in terms of hardware requirement and also in terms of the power dissipation. If needed, more emphasis could be given to the software, and if needed, the more emphasis could be given to the hardware. So it's a balancing act between the hardware and software to ensure the power dissipation. I mean, to ensure the minimum power dissipation. Okay. So So this is hardware software co-design approach for minimizing switching power dissipation. Next class we'll be talking about the other techniques like fast encoding, clock gating, and the finite state machine clock gating. So if you have any question, please feel free to ask. Anybody, if you have any question, please feel free to ask.
Sir, how to trade off between hardware and software? How do you implement it?
So I cannot hear your voice. Can you repeat the question once again?
Hardware, software trade off will be done how? Means how will it be actually implemented?
So it will your question is how to partition hardware and software for a given problem. So that depends upon designer. Okay, and you can see that this loop can be followed. The designer which has expertise in let's say that system designing, that that can decide how to at least to start how to divide the problem into hardware and software part. Okay, so it depends upon the skill of the designer, you can say. And then this you can say flow chart can be implemented. It can be followed in order to ensure that the best partitioning for the given problem. It has to be done again and again in order to ensure the best performance in terms of area as well as the power reduction. So that's why, otherwise if there were some techniques present that will ensure that everything will happen in one shot, then it's so easy, but it's not so easy. Okay, so it's a given problem will be judiciously divided into hardware and software by the designer, then co-synthesis will happen, then system integration will happen, and then the co-simulation will be performed so that to estimate the performance of that processor in terms of power and performance. And then if it's not up to the satisfaction level or it's not up to the target, then we have to go back to again hardware and software partitioning. Okay, and I must say that I mean this you can also discuss this with your professor who has expertise in digital circuit design, digital system design, who can tell you more about actually a given problem will be partitioned into the hardware and software. Any other question? Any other question? Sahil, do you have any question? Rashmi, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Question any doubt? Hello. One thing.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any question? Then we'll stop here today. I will share this slide to all of you. I will send slide through the email. And I must say that you should also follow the book by Ajit Pal. Okay, all the most of the content are taken from the books. If the content is taken from some other source, then It has been mentioned in the slide, so you can also open that original source and you can read those concepts.
Sir,
thank you very much. Yeah.
Do you have PDF of Ajit Pal book?
Hello,
sir. Do you have PDF of Ajit Pal book?
Okay, you can call me over phone. Okay. The PDF is a basically a book. Up PDF of a book is a copyright matter.
Okay.
Okay. So you can call call me over phone. So we'll discuss. Okay.
Sir, can you get this recorded lecture?
You can. It is on the cloud. So I will give you a link to access these recorded lectures. Okay.
Okay, from the beginning one.
Yeah, from the beginning one. I have a recording of each and every lecture. Okay. So I will share that with you.
Okay, sir.
I will also upload this to my YouTube account. You can also watch this from there. Okay.
Okay, sir.
My YouTube channel is there on YouTube channel, so you can open that.
Yes, sir. You have already shared.
Most of the lectures are there. Few lectures are not there, so I will also upload those lectures. Okay. One lecture is missing, so I will also upload that lecture and also upload today's lecture. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Bye. Yeah. Any other question?
Share the PDF file.
Yeah, I will share also. Okay, I will send email to all of you.
Sir, because in the video lectures it is difficult to go through the whole PDF file.
I will send also. I will send the course material. I will send the PDF as well as I will also send the PPT to all of you. Okay. Anybody, if you can call me sometime and remind me, then I will do this. Okay. Okay. So thank you very much for today's lecture. What about tomorrow? What about tomorrow? Tomorrow is a holiday.
Holiday.
Okay. So if you are willing, then I can take a class. No problem. Would you like to join class tomorrow? So we'll have a class tomorrow, okay?